Mai, e rongo i te kāanga o te kaupapa nei, ki ngā kai kōrero e tū i moi a hau, engara e pāwhiri, tēnā koutou. E mei nui hoki, tēnei kia koutou, rangatahi ko tai mai nei, ngā tō rangahau o kia roha, nei nga te mihi kia koutou. Me o koutou whānui whānui, and hei le kua whakatoa, tēnā koutou mai mai, ada mai whakatau mai, i roto i tēnei whariwanana. ki ngā kai hautu o tēnei waka rangahau, o Inzari, koutou katoa ngā kai mahi whakatū mai, whakahaere tēnei hui, nei a te mihi kia koutou, ngā kai āwhina, ngā kai tautoko. Ngā koutou tēnei hōrere e hō mai, kia oi tēnei rangi, kia tū hei kai kōrero mo tēnei kauhai, mo te Herbison Lecture Noira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātā katoa. Ko ai tēnei e tūaki, o te tai mokopunga o te maunga tītohia, me te maunga hoki o Kariwai, ko Taranaki, ko Kariwai ngā maunga, ko Waitara, ko Waikato, ngā awa. Ko te ate awa ko Ngāti Mahanga, ko ngā mahanga taere, o ku iwi, ko Ngāti Rāhiri, tōku hapū, e mihi kau atu ki a koutou. Ko ai tētahi o ngā kaimahi, ngā kai rangahau e rote te whare, rangahau o te matipununga, o te kotahi. No reira ka uri ngā mihi, ki aku kai, ho haere aku ho mahi, ki aku te mo tō, mihi atu mo te rōpū. Tēnā tātou katoa. E rongo i ngā kōrero a Agnes go if you pūpū. Māori mā tū reiti. Engari, ka rongo i rongi te aroha, te rape a ka kauhau i roti te aroha. O te rafa kāo, Agnes, kei hiawe. So I just wanted to acknowledge to the all of the award winners for Inzari for this year. It is a real honour to be acknowledged by this organisation, particularly when we've been, all of us in this room have been working for the wellbeing of our tamariki mokopuna, taetukina kotiki, within the education system. And so, as a Māori educationalist, I was really fortunate to come through a very strong Māori education team at the University of Auckland that really laid the foundation, and I realised as we stood here, Te Kotahi from the University of Waikato, that half of us were from that team. and to really acknowledge Linda and Graham. Graham has been here, I'm not sure if he's still here. And Linda's in San Diego at the moment, for their foresight to support and mentor a group of upcoming and emerging academics at the University of Auckland. And that's something that we've maintained a commitment to as we've moved to the University of Waikato, to Te Whare Wānanga, Oanuiarangi, to the various institutions that we now work in. The kaupapa remains the same in terms of kaupapa Māori and operating within the kaupapa Māori framework for the well-being of all. So I want to acknowledge all of us gathered in this room, and I want to acknowledge all of our tūpuna, all of our ancestors who are also gathered, having their own hui, our wairua, trying to make sure we don't throw too many words around that we might regret. Not that I do that. But really I do want to acknowledge to Cynthia Coburn and Bob Linger for the keynotes for Inzari this year, and this morning to Mary Berriman, who really said a lot of what I wanted to cover, actually. Probably in a more polite way. So Mary, it was really lovely to hear your talk this morning, your presentation this morning. And the first, so this is where I'm from, in terms of, so I have connections here to Waikato through Ngāti Mahanga, from the other side of Kilikili Law through to Whainua Law. But I was born and raised under this mountain, and it kind of contexts me, I think, in terms of the way in which the kind of ancestral memory that I carry, and that really influences the way that I work, and the way that our team works within Te Kotahi. Because it's very difficult, I think, to be born and raised under such a magnificent tūpuna and not feel that you have to make a contribution to the well-being of this world. This is our whare at all Waitila. This is something that has always, a place that's always really been a place of reflection, really, in terms of my life. And being from Waitila, I'm both a river and a coastal person. So we don't have any particular singular characteristics when you have mountain, river and coast. Fortunately, we don't have water, so I'm not overly confused. This is Waitila, and I wanted to bring this, can we talk a little bit about history and the debate around history that we are currently, there's an ongoing debate around history and the teaching of Māori history and Māori knowledge in schooling, and Mary raised that this morning. This is the what they would call the Peka Peka block. And this block is currently under significant discussions because it still remains as leased land with the New Plymouth City Council, who are seeking to sell this block for an $80 million profit on top of the many profits that they've had. Now, when I was going to school, I never knew that. I never knew that we lived on leased land. I never knew that my father paid every year a lease to live on his own land. And so knowing the history of our own land and that we walked on Grey Street and McLean Street and Brown Street and Dominic Street, those names meant nothing to me as a child. But the pain that we felt in that community meant everything to me. And so not having that knowledge of this place really had a serious impact on my own whānau and our own intergenerational way of operating. Another really influential part of my life, which I think really makes me a lot of who I am, comes from the saying from Te Kite O Rongo Mai, Tūtama Wahine I Te Wā Te Kore. And so standing as a Māori woman, as a Taranaki woman, as a Te Atiama woman in that time, and that saying was around when the men were removed in November 1881 and shipped in chains to Littleton and to Dunedin, where they were imprisoned. He said that saying came from them, Tūtama Wahine I Te Wā Te Kore, which meant that Māori women would take on all roles that were required for the well-being of our people. So I just want to give a little context around that because it's very influential, I think, in terms of the work that we do. And this is my most modern influence, and these are my tamariki. And I have four mokopuna now. This new one here, Waiariki, was just born a month ago. So I now have six children and four mokopuna. And everything I do is for past, present, and future generations. And when we're looking at schooling, and we're looking at where we're at in terms of Māori education, we should always be thinking about that. We should always be thinking about what influence do I have now on this person, and how will that then influence seven generations into the future? And Karina Walters, who's a child law academic researcher and historical trauma who works a lot with Michelle Johnson Jennings and Derek, who are here, we'll always talk about being standing as the granddaughter of her grandmother and the grandmother of her granddaughter in the one moment, at the one time, in the one place. So we're all simultaneously, all of these things, at the same time. So I wanted to revisit the opening tongi that both Brahman and Margie talked about. We begin with the first keynote. And all of you must have heard this 20 or 30 times. So the hope is that you've heard it enough to actually now know it without reading it. Because that's language only. So mehe mea ka moe moe ai, ko a anaki, mehe mea ka moe moe a tātou, ka tāe e tātou. Oh, that's right. Yes. Yeah. Take mine.
It's been a
lot.
Is that
right?
It's been a
bit. I'll take you with that. So if I dream alone, only I benefit. If we dream together, we can succeed. If we all dream together, we can all succeed together, we can all achieve. So there are a lot of learnings in this whakatauke that go beyond what we may take in the initial reading of it. Firstly, at the most simplistic level, this tonga is about reminding us to dream. I think that has been one of the greatest strengths of the Māori education movement, is that we've always dreamed and had a vision and had a hope for something better for our children and something better for this country. And so we've always strived for a systemic change that would help bring that about. So for Indigenous people, dreaming is important. Dreaming is life, dreaming is knowledge, dreaming is vision, dreaming is methodology, dreaming is pedagogy. Dreaming is a learning space for the dreamer. Dreaming is an ancestral teaching place. Dreaming is a spiritual and cultural-based learning centre. Secondly, it reminds us of the collective reciprocal relationships that we have. In one way, it's a kōrero whakatūpato, a cautionary reminder. In an educational context, if we dream alone, the benefits will be limited. We can talk about that in today's terms as perhaps a reminder that the individualisation that's encapsulated in schooling systems driven by national standards, market-driven privatisation, systemic racism, hierarchies of knowledge, language, and achievement will always privilege some individuals over others. It can also be a reminder, and I have this Graham Smith voice in my ear, cautioning us about our role as academics. The need to be wary of a neoliberal agenda of the privatised, individualised academic who works entirely for self-gain. And does not contribute to the wider agenda of collective well-being. Thirdly, this tonga brings forward the strength of the collective. Te puia highlights our collective responsibilities, our obligations, our collective accountabilities, our collective power of working for a common cause for the well-being of the people. So when I think about the idea of partnerships, as a researcher would do, a number of questions jump to mind. So yeah, te mui muia, what is the dream? Ko wai tātou e mui muiana, who are the we who are in the dream? Who are the we in the partnership? What is the promise? Who defines the promise? And who benefits from taking it to praxis? So within the teachings and learnings of Te Puia, we're clear that she was about the well-being of iwi, the well-being of Waikato Tainui, and in the context of the Kingitanga as a national movement, the well-being of Māori as a whole, and the well-being of Aotearoa. Te Puia, like many great leaders in our history, was as much about praxis as she was about dreaming. As noted in the opening of the conference, Te Puia also left us the message or the tongi, mahi a te mahi, do the work. Actually, the fullness of her message was, mahi a te mahi hei paina o te iwi. Do the work for the well-being of the people. So when we associate this mahi a te mahi hei paina o te iwi to a colonial education system, we see that the Pākehā system in this country has never been based with an aspiration for the well-being of Māori. We just have to look at the history and the origin of the system to know that. And we've had many educational historians, some of who are in this room, that have provided us with much evidence that for 200 years, the system that we're operating in, the education system, has been grounded upon visions, dreams, and promises that have been imported from elsewhere. and have been imposed on the visions, dreams, and aspirations of the Indigenous nation. The history of schooling in Aotearoa is one that many of you know, but it still remains a history that many outside of education know little about. It still remains a history that many will ignore. As within the system that we're operating within, there's still a failure to teach the history of this land in any depth, or with any commitment to meaningful relationships with whānau hapūnemi. The history of schooling in Aotearoa is a history of schooling as a tool of colonisation, a mechanism of assimilation, a process of indoctrination and Christian colonial beliefs, and as an instrument of domestication of Indigenous people globally. Where colonial schooling was established in 1816, the foundations for the philosophy underpinning it were set well before the very first mission school opened its doors in Nangihaua in the north. Schooling, however, became the way for the infiltration of colonial thinking, attitudes, practices, knowledges, and systems into Māori communities. But assimilation was not merely limited to a missionary intent. It was a part of a wider native policy that was developed by colonial settler governments. Colonial schooling was also a vehicle for a wider agenda for the disposition of Indigenous nations from their lands. It supported a process that was first and foremost focused on Indigenous land and resources that imperialism sought to possess. Early engagement by Māori with mission schools in the colonial administration was undertaken through a belief that our people could benefit from the inclusion of new technology. Interest in school was not merely located in the ability to read and write, but was also to gain access to a knowledge of key instruments that our people believed would support the overall interests of hapūnemi. However, hapūnemi were operating from a position that schooling would add to rather than replace, as noted by Judith Simons. They engaged in what may be considered and what could be seen as an early form of educational partnership with the Crown or with the state. In 1816, our ancestors were in the majority. In 1816, we held most of our land. In 1816, we were fluent in te reo Māori, tikanga ahapu, and tikanga iwi. In 1816, those things were not in the street. As such, the early engagement were from a place of strength in terms of rangatira tiritanga, in terms of population numbers, and in terms of embedded and intergenerational cultural knowledge and practices. It is well documented, though, that the speed at which our people gained expertise in the written world was directly attributed to literacy being conducted in te reo Māori. However, any belief in partnership was soon lost as disease, population dissemination, ahau for land increased exponentially. So by 1840, many of our people considered that te tiriti o Waitangi was a necessary covenant that would be enabling of the formation of a new form of relationships in a context where significant changes were happening. This clearly was not the underlying intention of either the missionaries or the colonial government. This was also the case across a range of Indigenous nations globally. Schooling served as a formalised colonial structure, as a vehicle for wider imperialist ideological objectives. The mechanisms through which schooling contributed to the broader colonial agenda differed across Indigenous nations. However, the intent was the same. They ranged from the facilitation of the civilising intent on Turtle Island, which many know as America and Canada, and on Aboriginal lands that people refer to as Australia, through the forced removal of Native and Aboriginal children from their nations, where generations of Indigenous children were forcibly removed, placed into residential boarding schools or missions that operated in the same way that prisons and detention centres, which continue to hold a disproportionate number of Indigenous people and continue to operate today. Through to the establishment here in Aotearoa of mission and native schooling, which Linda Smith has referred to for some time as Trojan horses in Māori communities. So 200 years later, and we're still waiting for meaningful partnerships with the Crown. The education system in Aotearoa continues to be grounded upon flawed assumptions that education and schooling will prepare Māori children to fit within an existing dominant system. And many talked about that this morning. The system continues to operate in breach of its treaty obligations. In the past 4 years since the establishment of the Waitangi Tribunal, we've been actively engaged in treaty claims and negotiating. Hapuanui, we have sought meaningful partnerships with the Crown and the establishment of schooling options for our people. What we continue to see in education is a Crown relationship with Māori that is positioned within the same power relationships where we struggle for change and where the kinds of governmental defined accountabilities that Bob spoke about yesterday are continually imposed upon our people and our community. As we're well aware, a key recent articulation of partnership was in charter schools. The system of charter schools in Aotearoa has had solid analysis from many people in this room and has had ongoing critique since we had the appearance of earlier neoliberal impositions in education from the 80s, such as the advocacy for vouchers, and then more recently, the imposition of national standards. There is a strong critique in Aotearoa of charter schools. And in the past few weeks, we have hoped with the election of a new Labour Greens and New Zealand First government coalition, we may see movement in this area. And I would really advocate for people to be active in sending briefing papers and letters to the new Minister of Education. So I'm not going to discuss that charter in depth, charter schools in depth, but I do want to indicate that a key way of promoting charter schooling has again relied on the construction of educational crisis for Māori. The kind of educational crisis positioning used to rationalise the implementation of neoliberal systems has been highlighted by Naomi Klein in her book, The Shock Doctrine. She highlighted the process of privatisation models and how they would move rapidly into areas of extreme levels of disaster or crisis. So here we see in this discussion from Klein the way in which Milton Friedman in his 90s was able to advocate and rapidly move charter schooling after what happened with Katrina in New Orleans. And as you can see in the very last line, the children are now scattered all over the country. This is a tragedy. It is also an opportunity to radically reform the educational system. Naomi Klein comments on Friedman's positioning and relates to them as disaster capitalism. The treatment of disasters as opportunities is equally applicable in Aotearoa. The disaster advocated here is one of the educational crisis for Māori, Pacific, and low decile communities. Charter schooling in Aotearoa has been described by the government as a new way of delivering public education. Its specific purpose is to enable New Zealand's most disadvantaged students to achieve greater educational success. These types of descriptions place Māori and Pacific students' achievement or underachievement as the centre of educational crisis, so that charter schools are expected to address. The ministry was even more innovative and creative in embedding that and describing charter schools as kura haurua and relating them to a moka culture, which aligns directly to Māori and Pacific nations. And we need to acknowledge organisations such as Save Our Schools and researchers such as Martin Thrupp, Michael Peters, William Smith, Graham Smith, and others in this room have provided us with an ongoing critique of the charter school system. What we see is that the Crown is using the Māori educational crisis to enable it to enable a justification for a neoliberal agenda. So Māori achievement and underachievement has been debated for many generations, with little enduring systemic change unless the Crown sees it as profitable. There's been an ongoing denial of the existence of institutional racism and the continued reproduction of a fundamentally monocultural focus of schooling systems and curriculum. Last year was the 200th anniversary of the establishment of colonial systems here on Māori land, and went virtually unrecognised. Like most historical events in Aotearoa, those that are challenged in terms of their colonial intent or agenda are met with an ongoing silence. So why is this important? Because for 200 years we've yet to see the history of this land privileged within state schooling. And we've seen a recent re-emergence of the debate over teaching of Māori history, in particular in relation to the colonial land wars, emerge through the 2014 petition of two Otorohanga College students, Leah Bell and Waimarama Anderson. When they were talking about their intent in creating the petition, Leah Bell made this comment: "We're fighting for justice. It is not blatant in the struggle, but there has been so much grief and pain buried in the unspoken history of our land wars within our beautiful country." Their positioning was also supported by the Māori Select Committee, who made this comment, and I want to come to the second part, that we recommend that the Education and Science Select Committee better promote a way in which curriculum content provides for the teaching of local Māori history in relation to the New Zealand land wars. This is also highlighted by Gillian Kidman, and she provided some insights into the silences that are part of denying historical information in this country, and highlighted that there is a need for these stories to be heard and taught within our schooling system, noting that difficult as they are to hear, the stories need to be told. So we continue to live in a selective memory in this country that denies historical events that underpin current contemporary Māori experiences and lived realities. We continue to experience a denial through the rationale that leads the teaching of our history to the choice of schools and teachers. This was a key reason why the national government over the past few years made the decision to not make the history of land wars compulsory in the curriculum. The ministry response highlighted their refusal to include colonial land wars as stating it would erode the autonomy of schools to determine their own specific content. The problem with notions of school curriculum choice is that what is taught, as Hui Aoki reminds us and highlights, is maintained in terms of Māori language and culture, are maintained as add-ons in the curriculum. While the ministry is unwilling to make changes to curriculum to include the discussion of this part of the history of Aotearoa, there continues to remain compulsion in other subject areas. As such, the refusal raises issues of the failure again for the Crown to operate as a treaty partner, or to operate in a way that one would expect an equitable partner relationship would function. So you may ask why I framed this keynote in such a way. Well, and we may like to think that after 30 years of critique of colonial patriarchy, class systems, that we as educational researchers have come a long way. That the assertions of educational philosophy within Kaupapa Māori in 2017 would be seen as not only valid and legitimate as a critical part of the indigenous culture of this land, but also that for Māori achievement and experience of success, these are critical elements for our people. All robust research evidence in this area indicates that Kaupapa Māori works. Yet we have in this conference heard many exciting presentations across sectors that have highlighted commitment to providing innovative ways to meet the needs of all students, including Māori and Pacific Nations learners. However, we've also been presented in some sessions with another revitalised version of the Lata and Openshaw anti-Māori tirades that have ranged around Māori education and Māori educationalists for many years. And I include the allies of Māori educationalists in there. Where for some time I've chosen to not engage those works, I have decided in this to make a conscious decision here to while I've chosen consciously not to engage those works, as I and others in this room have made a decision to continue as Te Puia advocated, mahi o te mahi, hei ōrana, hei pā. It seems that within a global conservatism that we see with Brexit and Trump, it's become more necessarily to directly respond to right-wing assimilationist approach taken by these authors. So today I want to make some comment on two extremely problematic presentations that caused concern for many working in Māori education, for Māori educationists and for allies. Two presentations that serve to reinforce the notion that Māori language, culture and knowledge has no place in schooling. Over the past 20 years, these authors, Lutter and Openshaw, have vetted unevidenced attacks on Māori educational initiatives, Māori scholars and Pākehā allies, which have been disguised in some form of neutral academic critique. Māori educational developments have been described through terms such as ethnic fundamentalism, secular religion, which to me makes absolutely no sense whatsoever, and politicised ethnicity, terms that appear to not actually have any true definitional substance, but they have been constructed to not only undermine Indigenous attempts to create and sustain kaupapa Māori contexts that work for our children, but more particularly these terms and their reductionist racist underpinnings have been constructed to benefit and reinforce those authors' own positionings of white privilege. White privilege and failure to not name Scorland's contribution to the maintenance of white privilege and to the construction of white spaces has been highlighted by Dr. Anne Mell. The supposed critique that has been provided by Lutter and Openshaw has no grounding in any actual fact or any research, and would be more correctly be viewed as opinion pieces rather than considered as serious academic articles. Claims that kaupapa Māori is not robust, that epistemic subject knowledge is more beneficial than cultural knowledge for Māori, that ethnic essentialism is the basis of Māori identity, that Māori are somehow taking over the world and denying democracy, and not only fundamentally flawed as a basis for any argument in relation to education in this country, but they are just wrong. There are similar arguments advocated by Don Branch and the Hobson Finch group that seek to remove all references to Te Tiriti o Waitangi and advocate a colonial assimilatory approach to all education in this country. Even more disturbing is the claim that the establishment of kura kaupapa Māori by these authors has caused Māori achievement underachievement rates to increase and Māori achievement rates to decline. The evidence shows that this can be no further from the truth, and to advocate such a position is dishonest and unethical. We need to question why we as researchers and why NZARE as an organisation continues to validate these types of presentations that are not grounded on any legitimate evidence, and the so-called findings which many in this room know are actually wrong. These are questions that are often raised in regards to how we as Māori deal with these types of discourses and assertions that are deliberately misleading or just plainly incorrect. And I recall a conversation a few years ago with Matua Tepne O'Regan when he was asked about his thoughts when an organisation, one of which I mentioned earlier, solicited thousands of copies of letters that stated the treaty was null and void. His response was very clear. If thousands of people sent letters saying the world was flat, what would we do with those letters? We would say, no, you were wrong. It is that simple. We can look at very general references to Māori achievement in relation to kura kaupapa Māori to see that those statements made in the presentations in the last 2 days, those two presentations, and in the earlier papers, have been deliberately made to deceive. There is plenty of evidence, both in terms of the ministry and a range of articles written by educationalists generally, that Māori achievement rates in kura kaupapa Māori have been significant in making a change in Māori education. So the underpinning of those colonial discourses that we heard in those presentations are not based on what we may believe to be any actual evidence or informed basis, and a number of authors in this room have solidly critiqued such false claims. Rather, these discourses are grounded in what I would call a politics of resentment or a politics of disgruntledness. We need to be clear that using a distorted idea of academic scrutiny to enable constant attacks on Māori initiatives and to undermine Māori educational movements and all of those that support those movements is not acceptable. These right-wing attacks have gone unanswered in a range of academic fora and conferences. However, if we are truly seeking to create enduring and meaningful treaty-based relationships within education, then it is time to speak out against the privileging of conservative assimilatory discourses that are being reproduced by researchers working against that promise. It's not an easy thing to do. Māori whānau, including academics, have often been marginalised for challenging discourses that marginalise our dreams and aspirations. What's equally disturbing about these assimilationist agendas appearing is that we have ample evidence that continues to highlight one, institutional racism continues to impact. Two, for many years the state has made it difficult for the establishment of new kuna. Three, that Māori educational movements are inclusive of anyone committed to the kaupapa of te reo and te kapa Māori learning. Four, that te kaupapa of Māori have contributed significantly to increased achievements for Māori students. And five, meaningful and inclusive educational options enhance Māori whānau involvement across all sectors. So for over 30 years, we have Māori, as Māori, have been in a struggle for the development, establishment, and validation of te kaupapa of Māori and whānau. We've worked across all sectors within education to create spaces where our children can, as Mason Drury says, live as Māori. This is a political context, and the nature of the work we do as educational researchers is political, as Jenny Morgan states. So as we speak of partnership, promise to practice, one of those key components in education is for Pākehā researchers, Pākehā academics and scholars to challenge directly those discourses that seek to deny Māori language, Māori culture, Māori knowledge and Māori rights. Again, as Anne Milne reminds us, it is important for Pākehā to take on this role. It should not only be Māori educationalists that stand and challenge assertions that Māori language and culture are socio-cultural knowledge forms that have no place in schooling, or that schooling is only for the reproduction of epistemic and rational knowledge, which really means Western, Pākehā, colonial and post knowledge forms. In order for Māori education to move fully into praxis, we need all educators to ally and take on the issues of the marginalisation of Māori language, culture and knowledge. For Māori educationalists, our aspirations, dreams and desires for our tamariki mokopuna can only be realised through a true honouring of te tiro te ao waitangi. The existing paradigm, as defined by the Crown, focuses on notions of settlement and symbolic compensation. Moana Jackson says that we all need to understand that treaties are not made to be settled, treaties are made to be honoured. So I want to close with this saying, this tongi from Te Puia. Te ora ke I taku moe maia, ko te pua waitanga o te whakaaro. Dreams become a reality when we all take it.